Welcome. My name is Scott Malone, and I'm a journalist with Reuters News, and I'll be your moderator today. Today's program is an hour long, and it's a collaboration of the forum at the Harvard T.H. Chan School of Public Health and Reuters News. Today's panelists, beginning from my immediate right, are David Hemenway, professor of health policy at the Harvard T.H. Chan School of Public Health and director of Harvard's Injury Control Research Center. Next to him, we have Felton Tony Earls, professor of human behavior and development emeritus, Harvard T.H. Chan School of Public Health. Moving down next to him, we have Mike McLively, a staff attorney at the Law Center to Prevent Gun Violence. And finally, David King, senior lecturer in public policy at the Harvard Kennedy School and chair of Harvard's bipartisan program for newly elected members of the U.S. Congress. This program will include a brief Q&A, and you may email your questions to the forum at hsph.harvard.edu. You can also participate in a live chat discussion that's happening on the forum website right now. Many of today's panelists, including myself, met in this studio 3 years ago to discuss gun violence in the wake of the massacre of 20 school children and six educators at Sandy Hook Elementary School. And as we sit here, authorities in California are investigating a report of a possible active shooter incident at San Diego's Naval Medical Center. And in the span of those 3 years, we've seen additional mass shootings, as well as an emotional President Obama just 3 weeks ago announcing a series of executive actions regarding the problem of gun violence. His steps included, among other items, clarifying that people in the business of selling firearms must get a license and conduct background checks, proposing a $500 million investment to boost access to mental health care, and ensuring that dealers notify law enforcement about the theft or loss of their guns. Today, we're going to look again at gun violence prevention through a public health lens and talk about what, if anything, has changed in the country's perceptions over the past few years. We'll discuss mass shootings as well as the day-to-day violence that many U.S. communities face. And we'll take a look at politics, policies, and laws. We're going to begin with a clip from Reuters showing President Obama making that announcement I just referred to earlier this month.
And the constant excuses for inaction no longer do.
A fired up and emotional President Obama moving ahead on gun control without Congress Tuesday, announcing a slate of executive actions beefing up background checks for gun sales in the wake of countless mass shootings.
From college kids in Blacksburg and Santa Barbara, and from high schoolers at Columbine, and from first graders in Newtown. Every time I think about those kids, it gets me mad. And by the way, it happens on the streets of Chicago every day.
The change is requiring all gun vendors to get a license, regardless of the size of their operation, plus new funds for mental health care, better tracking of people with mental health issues, and improvements in gun safety technology.
This is not a plot to take away everybody's guns.
Andy Sullivan is following the story.
Well, keep in mind, for any significant change in the laws, Obama has to go through Congress, and he's been unable to change the existing laws we have now. Think back to 2013 when Democrats tried to make background checks more universal. They fell short. This is likely to enrage Republicans in the National Rifle Association. Still, there's about 32,000 Americans who die of gun violence every year, and Obama says that anything he can do to bring that total down even just a little bit is worth doing.
Thank you very much, everybody.
Congress has not approved major gun control legislation since the 1990s, as the powerful NRA has worked to knock down all attempts to rein in gun ownership.
So with that, we'll pass the conversation over to David. David, tell us a little bit about what Obama's announcing, and just give us some of the big picture about gun violence in this country.
So what I wanted to talk a little bit about was the public health approach, and just to emphasize that what the president is doing is really an important part of that public health approach. We have lots of guns in the United States. We'll probably always have lots of guns, and the public health approach is about harm reduction. It's about prevention. What it's really about is to try to make it easy to be healthy rather than difficult to be healthy. And in a public health approach, everyone should play a part if you want to have an effective public health approach, and that includes gun manufacturers, gun retailers, gun owners. It includes the faith community, the medical community, and it even includes the president. What the president has been doing is trying to do whatever he's able to try to reduce the problem. And I would argue that it's not just changing laws that can make a difference, it's also changing social norms, which is important. And before the first step, really, in trying to make sure everyone's together and on the same page, you all have to agree, everyone has to agree that we have a problem that can be solved. And we have an enormous problem in the United States. On an average day in the United States, over 300 people are shot. So a lot of spinal cord injuries, traumatic brain injuries, and of those 300 plus, we have more than 90 people dying. If you compare us to any of the other advanced countries, we have lots more guns, particularly handguns. We have by far the weakest laws among the two dozen first world countries. And not surprisingly, we have a much more serious gun problem than any of these other countries. On average, a person in the United States has a much higher likelihood, for example, of being murdered with a gun than people in other countries. And it's not just 20% higher or 50% higher. It is 25 times higher than the average of all the other advanced countries. And our overall gun death rate is 10 times higher. And people in all the other advanced countries, from Germany to Japan to Italy to Canada, just cannot understand the United States, why we seem to do so little to try to prevent these problems. Now, gun violence just doesn't kill people. It also helps destroy communities. When there's street crime with guns, what it can do is make it less likely for people to be willing to go out at night, much less likely for industry and business to come into the community and really be devastating for the community. Over the last 20, 25 years in the United States, crime has gone down. Burglary's gone down, robbery's gone down, assault's gone down. This is true not only in the United States, but it's basically true in all the other developed countries as well. And so at the same time, in the United States, household gun ownership has gone down. Number of guns per capita has actually gone up. But to explain crime going down, you have to explain why it's going down throughout the developed world. And because crime is going down, not surprisingly, gun crime is going down and gun homicide is going down. Unfortunately, in the United States, gun suicide has been going up. And there are many more gun suicides than there are gun homicides. There are many more non-fatals from homicide, but many more fatals from suicide. And what I just want to end in my talk is just saying is that one of the things we know for sure in the United States is that a gun in the home increases the likelihood that someone in the home will die a violent death. From gun accidents, from a woman being murdered by a man in an intimate partner violence situation, and particularly by suicide. The evidence is overwhelming from case control studies and ecological studies, for example. Why do we have very different suicide rates across cities, across states, across regions in the United States? To explain the differences in suicide rates across states, turns out it's not well explained at all by differences in mental health. It's not well explained at all by differences in the number of psychiatrists. It's not even explained by differences in suicide ideation among the population or even suicide attempts. What really explains the difference in the United States across the populations is the number of guns, because it's gun suicide which is so different.
And that's probably a good point for us to move the conversation along to Tony. Talk a little bit more about that problem, the risk out there.
Well, David's right that 61% of firearm deaths, we have 33,000 firearm deaths in the United States, 61% are related to suicide. And the stigma surrounding suicide and the sort of absence of media attention to suicide makes it a kind of silent aspect of this firearm epidemic that we have. I'm in the editorial board of the American Journal of Psychiatry, and we turned to Switzerland to find the kind of research that really reveals the importance of firearms in suicide. This was a study done in 2007 to 2011 following a legislative act in Switzerland to reduce the size of the army. You know, Switzerland is one of those countries that has a civil militia, that every male has a gun as part of the civil militia. So the government decided to reduce the size of the militia by 40%. And that was a natural experiment to look at whether or not the withdrawal of guns from the people who were in the militia was related to a decrease in suicide. And what was shown with great precision is that only males between the ages of 18 and 37, 38 had a reduction in suicide. That women didn't have a reduction in suicide, and older males didn't have a reduction in suicide. So the suicide, the 30% suicide drop was directly related to the fact that men no longer had access to guns. That the references for these articles are provided by the school. And I just want to say that, suicide is a problem not just of some sectors of some demographic sectors of American society, but it's across the board. There's been a concern that suicide rates in African Americans are lower than whites. But when you look at 15 to 19-year-olds, African American males have a high suicide rate, the highest suicide rate in that age group compared to other groups. So we need more research and more attention to suicide as part of the firearm death solution. Let me just say one thing briefly about the streets of Chicago that the president said, that what's happening in African American communities and poor communities in the United States is that the segregation that has existed and has been part of American history is not going away. That hyper-segregation still exists in Chicago. That the structural inequality is a very prominent part of the city, not just Chicago, but American society. And that the level of inequality has reached an extreme level. In that context, what it means is that people who live in those communities lack trust, lack civic engagement, have what we call low collective efficacy. Given the gun availability and drug use becoming, particularly heroin, opiate use, becoming a new problem in society, that these communities are weighted down by economic, by personal, by access to drugs, by access to guns. And we're in critical need of understanding that problem much better and designing public health interventions that curtail this from becoming a very large epidemic in American society. So I'm very worried about the current circumstances.
Okay. With that, let's pass the baton along to Mike and explain a little bit about the Law Center.
Sure. Well, the Law Center to Prevent Gun Violence is a nonprofit organization that was founded in San Francisco after an assault weapons massacre at a law firm there in 1993. So for the last two decades, we've been really analyzing the problem of gun violence in this country and looking at what we think are common sense, effective legislative solutions to this problem. So part of what we do is we track bills that are pending across the country. Last year, 1,300 bills in a single year. So there's a lot of action. We also track Second Amendment litigation that's going on in the courts challenging those laws across the country. So we really have our fingers on the pulse of what's happening both in our state houses and in our courthouses across the country when it comes to gun violence and efforts to prevent gun violence. So really quickly, I just want to paint a picture of the laws in this country and give you a sense of sort of where we're at. So the first thing you have to understand is that our federal system of laws pertaining to guns, especially compared to other developed Western nations that don't have nearly the same rates of gun death that we do, are very weak and they're not comprehensive. And they really sort of create a minimum baseline that states can choose to build above and create stronger laws. But as you'll hear in just a moment, not a lot of states take advantage of that. So, and in fact, sometimes our federal laws work against us in many ways. And just one example is that in the mid-90s, Congress actually essentially shut down funding for the CDC to study the issue of gun violence. So we know this is a huge problem, and we've actually tied one, if not two, hands behind our backs, thanks to our federal laws really preventing us from even studying this epidemic. So we have this weak baseline. What are the states doing is the next question. So one of the things my organization does is we give a grade to the states each year based on the strength or weakness of their gun laws. And what we've seen over the last few years is that more than half of the states Last year it was 26 states got an F grade. So they're failing. They're doing nothing above that pretty low federal threshold. There are a few states, California, New York, here in Massachusetts, a handful of others that do fairly comprehensively regulate firearms, but they are definitely a distinct minority. And what we see when we compare the death rates in states to their laws is that there's a very strong correlation between states having stronger gun laws and lower gun death rates. And the reverse is true when states have weak gun laws, you see higher gun death rates. And that's true across the board. And we also see crime guns moving from states with weak laws into states with stronger laws, which sometimes undermines efforts to prevent gun violence. So in Chicago, for example, 60% of crime guns recovered there came from outside of the state of Illinois, oftentimes from Indiana, which is right next door and has very weak gun laws. So we see those patterns, and that sounds pretty bleak, but I'm hoping later on today to tell you some positive developments that have happened at the state level and in the courts. There is some good news to report, so stay tuned.
Great. And given that picture of the state level, David, why don't you walk us over the situation in Congress and what we can expect?
Well, I'm excited to hear from Mike about what the positive developments are. It's interesting because we were here 2.5, 3 years ago, and I really enjoyed being part of the panel, mainly because I was getting to hear from everybody else. And I think what I offered up back then was a bit of a downer for folks, because I said, yeah, right here now in the wake of Sandy Hook Elementary School, nothing's going to happen at the federal level. It's not going to happen. I got people texting me, what are you, crazy? How could that be? Because in the wake of a shooting like that, when there's a lot of pressure for some kind of a federal change, that's when the National Rifle Association and others are at their strongest. They're going to be defensive. That's when you don't expect to see change. But there has been an important shift over the last 2.5 years. And it's not because of any weakening by the National Rifle Association or any other gun groups. It's because of a shift in our way of thinking about gun violence. I don't even like the phrase gun violence. We don't generally change anybody's mind once their mind is made up. And certainly people out in America have made up their minds about the Second Amendment or gun control. There's very little wiggle room on this. So if you have one side saying, this is what we want, and the other side saying, now you're wrong, and using inflammatory language, nobody can ever shift. Nobody can move. What's been so interesting in work that David and Tony have worked on for the last few years is that we shift the conversation from gun violence to public health more generally. You don't change anyone's mind by yelling at them or providing them with facts. You change the conversation. You change the underlying associations with an issue, especially on something that's so core and fundamental to who we are in the United States. I think most Americans would say, thank God we're not like Italy or France or Germany or Japan. Absolutely, we don't want to be. There's a sense of rugged individualism here. There's a sense of liberty here. There's a sense of freedom here that we don't, and we take some pride in that. And we in the policy community need to embrace that and understand that in Congress, we're going to move forward, if at all, with sensible gun ownership. Sensible gun health. And if we can change the frame from talking about gun violence to gun health, we can stop talking so much about assault ban weapons and start recognizing that it's our teenagers, it's our children, it's people who we know who are committing suicide. Over 60% of the gun deaths are suicide. If we start talking about that as opposed to this is my right, this is what it means to be an American. Actually, part of what it means to be an American is that we care for each other, and we care for our families, and we care for our rights. And if that can all be embraced in a more holistic way, I think we can move forward. And we absolutely have seen shifts in that direction in the last 2.5 years. President Obama's move with an executive order was the only thing he could do because Congress is blocked. But I'm excited to hear from Mike and others about what they see as progress as we move forward. And for those of you who are here or watching, please try and understand, if you are pro-gun control, try and understand where the Second Amendment folks are really coming from. If you haven't actually fired a weapon, if you haven't been to a gun range and tried one out yourself, you might want to. You might want to understand what it feels like and what the culture is like, because only then will you be able to make a plausible, realistic argument in defense of gun health, public health, and then maybe we can shift the conversation and move forward.
Great. And as we all know, we're in the middle of a presidential election year. And now we're going to take a look at another video clip from Reuters about how the nation's series of shootings has encouraged gun control activists and how that may or may not affect the presidential campaign.
After the latest mass shootings in Colorado and California, the gun control movement thinks 2016 may finally be its time. Ginger Gibson has the story.
Gun control activists are optimistic for the first time in decades that a series of events, tragic shootings, is giving them the ability to persuade more voters to their side, especially in the wake of these most recent attacks.
Every Town for Gun Safety, a group advocating for stricter laws, now has over 3 million members and is getting ready for a major push.
Much of the support for this movement in terms of dollars is coming from former New York Mayor Michael Bloomberg, who's pledged $50 million to help the cause. They're working to get initiatives on the ballot that they think will draw more of their supporters to the polls. They've already test run ads.
Politicians' condolences aren't enough. It's time for them to act.
And I will continue to take on the gun lobby.
There's also Hillary Clinton taking a stand on guns in a way she never did in 2008.
We need to have comprehensive background checks.
Clinton's change of heart likely linked to polls showing American voters largely support some increase in gun laws, such as the universal background check to buy a firearm. But that still may not be enough to counter the National Rifle Association.
We've seen in previous instances, while quiet in the immediate aftermath, they then began pushing their supporters to discourage any type of restrictions on gun laws. We know that the NRA will likely be spending heavily in the coming election, and that they aren't going to just sit on the sidelines while their opponents grow in strength.
But there are signs all the gun violence is spurring action. Every Town said it signed up 20,000 new members in the hours after the California assault that left 14 people dead.
So with that in mind, let's talk a little bit about ideas to prevent gun violence. That clip showed some hope that the elections may turn a bit of a spotlight on the issue. David King, what's your take?
Well, it's interesting with the Hillary Clinton clip that we just saw. We need to remember that she's playing to a primary audience, a primary constituency, and they're certainly not going to be pro-gun. The very interesting element from that clip was the role of the National Rifle Association. We talk about them as that they are this 800-pound gorilla. It's false, right? They're basically a 1,200-pound gorilla. They are massive. And their spending and their reach is quite remarkable. But like with all interest groups and lobbying groups, they play in a competitive environment. And 2 years ago, it was absolutely fascinating to watch in the state of Colorado, a group that just kind of emerged to begin the recall petition for a couple of state legislators. It was called Rocky Mountain Gun Owners. Fabulous and very, very interesting group that positioned itself to the right side of the NRA. The NRA was kind of caught off guard. And Rocky Mountain Gun Owners made huge headway. NRA then stiffened their position within Colorado and has tried to muscle Rocky Mountain Gun Owners out. So if you go to rmgo.org, it's really interesting because they say on the right at the very top, Colorado's only no compromise gun group. Every lobbying organization, every interest group is in a competitive environment, and they're always worried about where their next paycheck is going to come from. They cannot show a moment of weakness and compromise. So the NRA is not going to shift and not going to change. The hope at the federal level, I think, is probably going to come more through the courts. And I have more hope at the state and local level, where we have citizen activists like you, understanding the community, reaching out and trying to build on those very basic laws that absolutely can be built on. This is not going to change all at once from Washington, D.C. It's going to change in the 36,000 towns, townships, and municipalities in this country, in the 3,033 counties in this country. It's going to happen at the local level and then possibly bubble up. So the campaign is kind of fun to watch right now. We're going to hear about gun control for probably into midsummer. But once we get into general election season, I don't think we're going to hear about it very much at the national stage. And that's when you really have to get busy locally.
Okay. And on that front, Mike, what do we see happening on the local and state level?
Sure. Yeah. So I think after Newtown, everybody saw the paralysis in Congress, and we saw that a universal background check bill couldn't even make it through a democratically controlled Senate. And I think a lot of people found that the narrative was, well, nothing's happening on this issue if it's not happening in Congress. But actually, at the state level, there's been quite a bit going on since Newtown, so since 2012. One of the things we've tracked is that there have been 125 significant gun safety reforms enacted since then in 41 different states. So not just in the states that you would expect, not just the usual suspects. And in particular, several states right after Newtown enacted comprehensive reforms. So we're talking about New York, Connecticut, and Colorado, significantly, a purple state, enacted reforms including universal background checks and a prohibition on large capacity ammunition magazines. So at the state level, there has been some progress. And in particular, if you look at universal background checks, since the Sandy Hook shooting, 8 different states have enacted universal background checks, bringing the total up to 18. So a lot of activity there. And one really interesting development was that in Washington in 2014, that was achieved using a ballot initiative. And so it was actually voters directly being asked, do you want this policy in place? And this really confirmed what we've been saying is true, is that polling numbers show that something like 90% of Americans support universal background checks. And so when we took this directly to the people in Washington, this policy passed by a wide margin. So I think the gun violence prevention movement is finding strategies at the state and local level to be more effective. I think it's worth noting that at the local level, there's a lot of problems right now with what are called preemption laws. Only 8 states don't have really strong preemption laws. So there's only a handful of states where local governments can really even get involved in this issue in the first place. And I think that was very much by design, and the gun lobby lobbied many states to enact strong preemption laws. So that's something that people should know about and is a bar to local governments taking action where they otherwise would. And in some states, if they try to take action, there's actually punitive damages that can be brought against the government officials that are voting for those policies. So that's something to be concerned about. But overall, there is a lot of progress at the state level. And in the courts, on the Second Amendment side, we've been tracking cases since 2008. That was when the Supreme Court first identified this individual right to bear arms. There has been lots of litigation challenging all kinds of gun control legislation across the board. I've now tracked over 1,000 decisions since then. And in 94% of the cases, the Second Amendment claim is rejected. So really, the courts are almost across the board saying, unless a law is extremely, extremely strict, like a prohibition on handguns in the home, like we saw in D.C., that was the 2008 case, these laws will stand. And the courts find that they're reasonably related to protecting public safety. So everything from background checks to prohibitions on certain dangerous weaponry, those are being upheld by the courts. So to say that all gun control laws violate the Second Amendment is just not true. And we're really trying to get that message out that these laws do not violate the Second Amendment.
Okay. Obviously, outside of the role of lawmaking, there are various steps that can be taken to control access, to affect access. David Hemenway, what can you offer on that?
Yeah, so I just wanted to talk a little bit about things other than laws, because laws are incredibly important, but in a public health approach, you're also trying to change social norms. So there's lots of things that can be done, for example, about suicide, about homicide, about gun accidents. Let's talk about suicide. What we'd really like to see is the gun manufacturers create guns which are hard to steal, which are hard for people who shouldn't have access to them to get access. This is one of the things Obama is trying to push by putting money into this kind of situation to try to make it harder for a teen to get access to a gun when he's depressed and kill himself. In public health, we've been working with gun shops, and I want to talk really about this notion about gun health. Gun shops don't like it when someone comes into their shop and buys a gun and then kills themselves. It's not good for them. It's not good for society. Nobody likes that. What can gun shops do to try to prevent the problem? And it turns out they can do a good number of things. For example, a woman comes into a gun shop and she says, I want to buy a gun. What kind of gun do you want? I don't care. How about this gun? Okay. How many bullets do you want? One's enough. Don't sell the gun to this woman. What you really want to do is know the way to get this woman help. And you can really help reduce suicide. Public health is starting to work with gun trainers. In the United States, for every gun death, unintentional gun death, there are 30 gun suicides. And yet gun trainers currently in the United States spend a lot of time about gun accidents and zero time about gun suicide. So right now there are modules being developed for trainers to be able to understand and talk about gun suicide, because when you bring a lethal weapon into your house, you have to worry about that. Gun owners can play a big role. Just as friends don't let friends drive drunk, also there's now a campaign to figure out ways for gun owners to make sure that if their friend has a gun and is going through a bad period, he just got divorced, he's talking crazy, he's drinking, for the friend to see it as their responsibility to help to get the gun out of the house for a while until things get better. The guy gets a new girlfriend and everything is much more better, and then you can get the gun back. And this is really incredibly easy ways to help prevent suicide. Physicians can do a lot of things. Right now, when there's a teenager at risk for suicide, the physician often creates suicide prevention plans. And one of the crucial things, which aren't in a lot of these plans but need to be, is to you have to try to prevent access to lethal weapons. And so there are lots of ways in which citizens and groups are using activities which aren't laws at all to try to prevent not only suicide but homicide and other things.
And it's interesting that you bring up gun owners, because certainly, I mean, there's very strong views on both sides of this issue. And I think many gun advocates would argue that, you know, they view the gun as a safety tool, as a crime prevention tool. And I think that should be said as well. With that, Tony, why don't you talk a little bit about the role of community in reducing violence?
I will, but let me just first say that one of the important things about the Swiss study that has not been revealed before is that with the reduction of guns in Switzerland and the reduction of suicide by guns, there was not a substitution for guns by using other methods, like running in front of a train or jumping off a bridge. And so the precision of that finding is extremely important. One of the things that concerns me with the president's remarks was that there wasn't much enthusiasm from the White House about the importance of doing research and releasing CDC from constraints it's had over the past years. And I'd like to ask David about that. As far as the community is concerned, I mentioned the impact of the economy and drugs that are becoming available, opiates in particular. The other problem in the African-American poor communities is the fallout from mass incarceration, that we have incarcerated very high numbers of people, as you know, over the last 20 years. And there is a bipartisan coming together now to realize that economically it doesn't make sense to lock up people, particularly with minor crimes. And so what's happening is that we're on the verge of having hundreds of thousands of men who've been in prison coming back to the community unprepared for family life or community life with marks from the incarceration. And it's an extremely important area that we need to do research, and we need to care and support these men in a relationship to the community. So with all the other things going on, the structural inequalities, that we have these drugs, we have this mass incarceration, we have poor school performance and high dropout rates, all predictors of violence. And it means that we have to be very active in this area.
Great. And let's bring it back to your question for David. David, talk a little bit about the challenges of collecting data.
Yeah. I wrote this book about success stories in injury and violence prevention, 64 documented successes. And one of the great things about it, that all the successes, was that data turned out to matter, and so did research. Incredibly important. Unfortunately, in the gun area, there's been withholding of data. We haven't been able to collect data. And when data are collected, it hasn't been provided to researchers. There's been roadblocks to it. And then there's been virtually no money for research. I always say that public health is underfunded relative to medicine. And within public health, injury and violence prevention is particularly underfunded. And within injury and violence, guns are incredibly underfunded. The CDC, for the last 20 years, CDC personnel have been afraid to say the word guns in public meetings. It's gotten to such an incredible state. There's no money at all from CDC. There's incredibly little from the Institute of Justice or the NIH. And foundations have not just stepped up. There's been a small number of foundations that have done something, but most major foundations are also afraid to give money in this area is because of the pushback. And so we're in an incredible situation where we, even if we're trying to do harm reduction work and we really don't know nearly as much as we should and we really don't have the data, and it's an incredible situation.
Yeah, I just want to add that this is a place where we have a classic clash of values. If this lack of data is really cast as a freedom of speech issue, right? We think about it differently. I was on the CDC site through a wonderful website called flowingdata.com. It does great infographics. I'm just playing around and you come across this infographic that explains that emergency room visits for people who have punched a wall, right, by age, and it peaks. You get all this great data and it sort of peaks around 14, 15-year-olds and then sharply goes down like this. Now, nobody's telling emergency room physicians you cannot report that somebody punched a wall. But they are telling emergency room physicians don't report on gun violence. Don't tell us about this. We're not going to collect this data. That's in direct conflict with what we hold value, what we hold really clear in this country, which is freedom of inquiry and freedom of speech. That's how the problem of data ought to be thought about, not as a gun versus something else, but freedom versus a lack of freedom.
Tony, what about what's the role that the mental health system can play in diminishing gun violence risk?
Well, it's very important to have access to mental health. And the communities that are hard hit with economic issues and public education issues and mass incarceration of males from those communities are the communities that have the poorest access to mental health problems. And so I think we know that the availability and easy access and reduction in stigma surrounding mental health are important conditions to satisfy in terms of rendering the service. But until the services are there and they're culturally aligned with the population and accessible and are not a cost burden, we're not going to have effective mental health treatment, but we know what to do.
Great.
Can I make a really quick point, Scott? So we've been talking a lot about suicide, and certainly that's a huge component of the problem, but I also just want to highlight for everybody there's 60 to 70,000 non-fatal injuries that happen every year. So those are people shooting other people. So a lot of times in this debate, we hear, well, 2/3 of the gun deaths are suicides. We can't stop those people from preventing suicide, which that in itself is false and should be addressed. But we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that there's another 60 to 70,000 people per year, in addition to the people being killed, who are being injured non-fatally, but this is a gun we're talking about, and a lot of times those injuries are very serious. So I just don't want us to lose sight of that when we're having this discussion.
And to reemphasize that is that in terms of violence between people, almost nothing has to do with mental health. Gun violence in the city has almost nothing to do with mental health. There are mental health aspects, of course, to the suicide issue.
Great. Now we have some time to open it up to questions. I believe we're going to start with one from our online audience.
Right. Thanks, Scott. We've had a number of questions coming in on email, so I'll just start with some of those. This is from Kathy Richardson. She had a few questions, but I'll just take this first one. Can you provide concrete examples of how chronic exposure to gun violence impacts children, teens, adults? Does long-term exposure to chronic gun trauma impair a child's ability to access social determinants of health and success? How? Can you give specific examples so that we understand the impact of gun trauma felt in the suburbs versus the impact of gun trauma felt in impoverished inner city neighborhoods?
Well, we published a study in 2005 that was published in Science that showed that children who were exposed to violence, specifically firearm violence, had a 2.5 times probability of committing serious violent acts themselves over a 2-year period of time. So it's, you know, and when we published the article, people said, of course we already know that. I mean, everybody knows that if you're exposed to violence, that you're likely to be more violent. But we didn't really know that from a scientific point of view. So we did a study that approximated a randomized trial, propensity stratification analysis, showing that this rate of increased likelihood of becoming violent was 2.5 times, controlling everything else about the child's environment and personality. So I think it's an established fact that it's a potent risk factor.
Thank you. Thank you. It's very interesting. Shall I take another from online?
Sure. Go ahead.
We've had some questions about open carry, and here's one. Is violent crime actually lower in states like Texas with open carry laws? Also, open carry advocates think it's important to have their guns visible so that members of the public become accustomed to the sight of people other than police officers carrying guns. Some have come armed to organized events and protests to make the same point. Not sure how this is increasing public safety at all. Are there any stats on that?
I can address the statistics. So right now, there are studies on both sides, and they've been examined, and essentially, I would say, when it comes to public carry of firearms, both concealed and open carry, we don't really know the effects. I mean, the most reliable study that I'm aware of comes from a researcher in Stanford named John Donahue, who's looked at this very closely, and has actually seen a bump in aggravated assaults for states that make it easier to carry firearms in public. Now, that being said, there are studies that say that the opposite is true, that crime actually goes down, but those studies have been, like I said, largely discredited, but at this point, it's part of the lack of data that we have. We just don't know 100% the answer to that question. But like I said, the most reliable study I know of shows a small increase in crime. But I think we also have to worry about the impact of these laws in terms of our culture and our society. And I think a very quick anecdote from Colorado Springs from last year illustrates that. And there was an incident where a man was carrying a rifle down the street. A neighbor saw him and called in to 911 and said, "I'm a little concerned. There's a man just carrying a rifle down the street." And the dispatcher responded, "Well, in Colorado, open carry is legal. He's not violating the law. We can't do anything." Hung up the phone. And a few minutes later, I think most of us know that person started opening fire and shooting at people on the street. And so it's just a question of public safety. And when open carry is the rule of the land, people carrying firearms around are not a problem until the moment they start shooting. So is that when we want to start intervening? I think we have to ask ourselves that question.
Okay. Do we have any questions from the room? Another one from online then.
Okay, great. As I understand it, a history of mental illness does not factor much into background checks for gun purchases, and it differs from state to state. With the president's executive actions focusing on mental health support, is this issue likely to now get more attention? I know privacy concerns are involved, but there must be some way to get mental health information into the background check process.
Yeah, I can field that just quickly. So there has been a lot of improvement in this area. After the Virginia Tech shooting, we had the NICS Improvement Act of 2007, one of the few things that Congress has actually done to move the ball forward on this issue. So a lot of states just weren't reporting mental health records at all, which is partly how the shooter in the Virginia Tech massacre was able to get his gun. So we've moved forward on that issue. I think there's still some remaining issues, and some of the president's executive actions help clarify that there aren't HIPAA violations, for example, to be reporting mental health data into the NICS system. So we're moving in the right direction, but I do think it's up to each state to really take responsibility for this. And until there's political pressure at the state level for that to happen, there'll still be records that aren't being reported to the system.
Can I add to that the president's executive actions are in the context of an executive order. And an executive order is in the Constitution under the president's powers to faithfully execute the laws of the land. So first there has to be a law that's been passed and is either already implemented or in the process of being implemented. And then the president can come along and say, I, as the chief administrative agent of the United States government, I'm going to tell the executive branch, here's how I want you to administer those laws. So that's what an executive order is, an order within the context of an existing law. So this morning, if you all paid attention to the Washington Post op-ed from the president, he has an executive order saying that you may no longer keep juveniles in solitary confinement within federal prisons. And that's because there's already a set of laws that define how these things are going to happen. The president says, I'm going to constrain it in the following ways. Well, here's where the presidential race is important, because an executive action, once done, can be undone. Because the next president who comes in is now the chief administrator for the United States government, and that president, he or she, can say, I have a different take. So anything done with an executive order can be undone with another executive order. So while these things are up and running, everybody else better get active and try and solidify it in some other way.
Now, David, earlier you referenced the idea of changing the language, changing the terms of the debate. And this is, like many issues in American politics, a very polarized one, where you have people who are very committed to their Second Amendment rights and think that efforts to limit gun ownership is going to be, at best, ineffective in reducing crime. On the other side, you have very strong voices to the contrary. Could you speak a little bit more on what might be done to move forward in terms of a policy conversation, so it isn't just two sides talking past each other?
Well, you have to expand the scope of the conversation. So if it's just pro-gun, anti-gun, remember that in a representative republic, democracy does not simply reflect sort of the average of public opinion. It's an interaction between the distribution of public opinion or preferences and the intensity of those preferences. And the people who care the most about the Second Amendment have it number one or number two on their list of things they most care about. And for many years, people who say, we ought to have stricter gun control laws, it's down there with campaign financing and gerrymandering reforms and all kinds of things that nobody really cares about. So a representative republic is this interaction between intensity and preferences. And that is not going to get unstuck unless we change the context of the conversation. So if we talk about children or our families or mental health or a wise use of public resources or freedom of speech, I think we're at least stepping in the right direction. And then you have to be able to, again, put yourself in the shoes of the Second Amendment absolutists and understand that they represent a fundamental and core part of American culture and history. And once we acknowledge that and embrace it, we can understand how possibly to move forward around faith and family and safety and health.
Great.
Can I just add to that?
Please.
That one area of work that I've been involved in sub-Saharan Africa is teaching children the science of HIV infection, partly to break through the stigma that exists, but also to put in place behaviors and access to testing that are important. And the core of this teaching is teaching children to be rational in their argumentation, to learn how to deliberate, to bring in knowledge and attitudes from outside their limited domain, and have a cross-examination and a deliberation about that. And it's been fascinating to see African children become effective, rational deliberators about HIV. What we're trying to do now in New Orleans, as one example, is to bring that technique, that methodology, to teenagers in New Orleans about guns. To have a rational discussion about how guns come into the community, how the families store and use and expect to use guns, and to widen the discussion so that it's not just people in your community, but it's people outside your community that influence the way your community operates. So I think that deliberative democracy is something that all ages can participate in. You don't have to, a 14-year-old can't vote, but he can deliberate about guns and about health and so forth. And the only other thing that I'm concerned about, Scott, David, and David, in particular, is that have you guys coined a new term in gun health? I've not heard that before. Have we hit on something here? What do you think, David? You used it.
I used it because David. I go out of my way never to say gun control, because that's just anathema to everybody. For example, I try to say gun policy, which is less of a problem. But there's no question that the way you word things really matters. And on polls, for example, if you ask people, do you want stricter gun laws? And they say, strict, no. But do you want stronger gun laws? Oh, yes, strong gun laws. It's like, isn't that the same thing? No, it's not. And so changing the conversation a little really makes a big difference. And looking at it in a slightly different way, and I think broadening it makes all the difference, too.
I'm fascinated by that. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Great. And I think at this point, we're kind of moving towards our conclusion here. And what I'll ask each of you is to offer just a brief, succinct policy recommendation, something that could be implemented to address the issue of gun health, as we're now calling it.
So what I would like to see is, maybe this is self-interested, is more data and better analyses. And so I would like to, as one simple policy, is to fund the National Violent Death Reporting System, which is this incredibly good data system, which is not now in all the states, to allow the CDC to ask questions about guns on the behavioral risk factor surveillance system, to allow researchers to get access to concealed carry information and tracing information. There's so much data that either it isn't being collected or is not allowed to be given to researchers, which would make a big difference in our understanding of exactly what is happening, so we can pinpoint the kinds of policies that are necessary and they're in a place like the United States where we're going to have lots of guns.
Great. Tony.
I'd like to see the Black Lives Matter movement embrace this issue, not just as a police issue, but as a community issue. And I think the sustaining and widening of that protest movement is important. And I think that the use of deliberative methods of analyzing one's environment and one's circumstances and the policies that surround them are good. Very important for the Black Lives Matter movement, but what I fear is that, like many protest movements, if it doesn't connect itself to the community, if it doesn't adopt strong techniques, that once the police violence issue subsides or the media coverage of it softens, that the protest movement will end in a protest movement, not in a capacity building movement, if you will.
Mike.
So if it's one policy, I would say universal background checks. I think we really have to get that done. But I want to step back and talk about something that David brought up, which is the intensity gap and sort of widening the scope in which we talk about gun violence prevention. And I think one positive development is the involvement of a group called Americans for Responsible Solutions. So if you recall, in 2011, former Congresswoman Gabby Giffords was shot in the head. She's since recovered and has formed this group with her husband, Mark Kelly. And what's really interesting about it is that they're both gun owners. So when we're talking about the conversation, these are people who own guns themselves, who have a respect for guns, use them safely, who are calling for changes to our laws. So the conversation isn't just, well, I hate guns, I didn't grow up with them, I don't understand them, let's take them away. It's, no, I own guns, but I think we need to be more responsible with how we use them. And I think when the conversation is framed that way, it changes things a little bit, because all of a sudden that charge that, well, you don't understand this, so how can you talk about regulating it, goes away. So the participation of that group at the legislative level and more people joining on to create a counterbalance to the NRA, I think, is a very important development.
I guess I would echo and support everything that you all said. Ultimately, I think the NRA and groups like it need to be part of the solution. So we can't simply try and have a counteract the NRA, but bring them on board to some kind of a solution. A specific policy is harder for me to identify, although when Tony was just speaking, this child in in Cleveland who had a toy gun and was shot down by police officers so quickly came to my mind. It's just a graphic and horrific thing to watch. And I understand the reaction in the Black Lives Matter movement. I also understand the reaction from police officers because they didn't see a black child, they saw a gun. And I think some of the most interesting and responsible and thoughtful people that you're ever going to find around gun safety and gun health are the first responders. Police chiefs, fire chiefs, people in EMS crews who are out there at the site of these very violent episodes or to clean up after a suicide. It affects them very deeply, and they have not been part of this conversation nationally and not very effectively locally. So everyone in here knows a police officer or a fire person in the fire department. Reach out to them as well. Ask for their perspectives, and we can gradually think about how to move things along in a more positive way.
Great. Well, that brings our conversation here in the room to a close, but I'd encourage our viewers online to keep up the dialogue on the forum's website, forumhsph.org. And I'd also encourage you, if you're interested, to tune in next month to our next forum titled The Aging Workforce, Challenges and Benefits for the Public's Health. That'll be on Thursday, February 11th, same time, 12:30 to 1:30. Thank you.